page 26, chapter 5. People who came and made an impact.
कौन हैं भारतवासी?
जाने कितने ही देशों से भारत आए लोग अनेक, रंग रूप वेश भाषा न थी जिनकी एक, कुछ लेने धन आए थे तो कुछ करने आए व्यापार। विविधता भरी सभ्यता का फिर यहीं बने आधार। कौन है हम में परदेसी और कौन है भारतवासी, नहीं जान सकता ये कोई, हम में बसी एकता ऐसी। हाँ, हम में बसी एकता ऐसी।
इस पाठ में हम भारतीय सभ्यता व संस्कृति की विभिन्नताओं के विषय में जानने का प्रयास करेंगे। भारत विभिन्न सभ्यताओं और संस्कृतियों का देश है। समय समय पर भारत में बाहर से लोग आते रहे हैं, जिनमें से कुछ भारत में ही सदा के लिए बस गए। इन विभिन्न बाहरी लोगों ने भारतीय सभ्यता और संस्कृति पर प्रभाव डाला, जिसको हम यहाँ खान पान, रहन सहन, वेशभूषा, रीति रिवाजों आदि में देख सकते हैं। इस पाठ में हम भारतीय संस्कृति पर पड़े कुछ प्रभावों को देखने का प्रयास करेंगे, विशेष रूप से तुर्कों और मुगलों के संदर्भ में। ये पाठ भारत की एकता और अनेकता को दर्शाता है। India's past is an interesting account of people who came in from time to time. They gradually settled down and made India their home. The Greeks, Scythians, Huns, Arabs, Turks and Persians were some of the groups of people who contributed towards the growth of the culture, which includes art and architecture, literature, dress, food, music, dance, painting, etc. In course of time, they influenced the existing culture and in turn got influenced by it. This led to the development of a mixed culture. There were many reasons that attracted people to the subcontinent. It is a known fact that even in the past, people traveled from one part of the subcontinent to another. Hills and mountains, including the Himalayas, rivers, deserts and seas, made traveling different and dangerous at times, but never impossible. So people moved for many reasons. Men, women and children moved in search of livelihood or fled from natural disasters like flood or drought. Sometimes armies marched for territorial conquest. Trade was another factor that made people travel. Very often, merchants traveled with caravans or ships carrying valuable goods from place to place. Some people traveled, perhaps driven by the spirit of adventure. Spiritual and educational needs also encouraged people to come to the subcontinent. Here is a small map which shows the Sulaiman mountain ranges, which are the southward continuation of the Himalayas, could be crossed through the Khyber and Gomal passes. The Sulaiman ranges are joined southward in Balochistan by the Kirthar ranges, which could be crossed through the Bolan pass. Page 27. How did people come to India? People came to our country through land and sea routes. People came from Iran, Afghanistan and Central Asia through the mountain passes as invaders, traders, travelers and immigrants. Mountain passes facilitated movement of people and later promoted trade and cultural contacts between India, Central Asia and West Asia. the Arabs and later the Portuguese, French, Dutch, and the British came to the subcontinent through sea routes. Knowing about India's past from the accounts of travelers, people who came to India wrote about India, its people, society, culture, and traditions. Some important historical events are mentioned in their accounts. Example, it is on the basis of Greek sources that we know about Alexander, the Greek ruler, his invasions and his conquests. The book Indica by Megasthenes, a Greek ambassador during the rule of Chandragupta, is preserved in fragments and is quoted by many writers. Here is a map which shows how the invaders or the traders came India from the Africa, which shows Cape of Good Hope, and which went up to India. They came to Bombay and some parts of Madras and Calcutta. Page 28. The book gives a detailed account of the Mauryan administration, social classes and economic activities undertaken by the people. Megasthenes' account, along with other literary sources such as Kautilya's Arthashastra, Vishakha Datta's Mudra Rakshas, and Jain and Buddhist texts also give a vivid picture of the Mauryan rulers and the ruling classes. Some of the Greek and Roman accounts also mention the existence of Indian ports and items of trade between India and the Roman Empire, 1st and 2nd century CE. Accounts of travelers who came from China also give an interesting account of our society, polity, and economy. Two well-known Chinese travelers who came to India were Fayan and Huanzang. They were both Buddhists. They came to India to visit the Buddhist shrines and to study Buddhism. Fayan came to the subcontinent about 1600 years ago and Huanzang came around 1400 years ago. Fayan describes the social, religious and economic condition of India during the Gupta period, while Huanzang gives us a vivid description of life and condition of the people during the rule of King Harsha. During the Mughal period, many European traders and travelers came to India. Some of them mentioned the living conditions of common people, including the peasantry. Ralph Fitch, who came to India towards the end of the 16th century, mentioned that people in Banaras, Uttar Pradesh, wear few clothes. Traveller Dilath mentioned that people did not have enough clothes to wear. Both of them mentioned that the living condition of the common people was simple yet difficult. Food items consumed by common people consisted of rice, millets and pulses. This was substituted with fish in Bengal and in coastal areas and meat in the southern parts of India. In the northern part of the country, wheat, pulses and vegetables were commonly eaten by the people. Art and architecture of the people who came at various points of time also made an impact on our diverse culture. In the Mughal period, the culture that developed was a mix of Turco-Iranian and Indian. Mughals built forts, palaces, gates, public buildings, mosques, and baulis, which is called water bodies and wells. Beautiful gardens, some of which continue to exist to this day, are the Nishat Bagh in Kashmir, the Shalimar Bagh at Lahore, and the Pinjore Garden in the Punjab. Page 29. In the field of architecture, the Turks and Afghans brought with them Persian and Central Asian styles. With the passage of time, these architectural styles merged with Indian styles. Buildings belonging to the Sultanate and the Mughal periods used domes and arcs. Both these forms were based on the accurate knowledge of mathematical and engineering skills. These forms were used in mosques, palaces, towns, and in the construction of private houses. The other structure that was frequently used was the tall, slender tower or minar. Decorations used in the building were largely Indian. The Indian features of architecture during the Sultanate and the Mughal period were also because most of the craftsmen who were involved in the construction of various buildings were mainly of Indian origin. The skill of the Indian stone cutters was fully used for the purpose. In the decoration of different buildings, the Turks used geometrical and floral designs. They also included panels of inscriptions containing verses from the Quran. The Arabic script itself became a work of art. The Indian features mainly consisted of the bell motif and lotus. Here's a picture of the dome and arch. The arch and the dome were known earlier, but they were not used on a large scale. Moreover, the correct scientific method of constructing the arch was rarely employed. And here are pictures of two major gardens of India. One is Nishad Bagh and the other is Pinjor Garden. Nishad Bagh is an Urdu word which means garden of joy. It is located on the banks of the Dal Lake. It is the second largest Mughal garden in the Kashmir Valley. Pinjor Garden is in the village of Pinjor, 22 kilometers from the Chandigarh on the Kalka-Shimla road. The garden was designed by Nawab Fidal Khan, foster brother to Aurangzeb. Page 30. Music also came to be enriched. The Hindustani style of music was influenced by forms from Persia and the Arab world. Certain instruments that became popular among the people were the sitar, sarangi and tabla. Language and literature were other domains that were influenced by the people who came at different points of time in the Sultanate and the Mughal periods. The court language in most parts of the country was Persian. Many of the regional languages were influenced by Persian. Persian words were commonly used in the vocabularies of many regional languages. Out of the mixture of Persian and Hindi grew a new language, Urdu. The grammar of Urdu was the same as that of Hindi, but the words were taken from Persian, Turkish and Hindi languages. Urdu spoken in the Deccan was influenced by Telugu and Marathi. In the west coast of India, Arabic was used by the traders from West Asia and it influenced the local language as well. Some well-known Sanskrit works such as Puranas, the Ramayana, Mahabharat were available in regional languages and they gradually got translated in Persian and Arabic as well. Some poems and plays were composed in regional languages and in Persian and Arabic. Few that became popular were Srinath's Harvilasa and Malik Muhammad Jaisi's Padmavat. Amir Khusro composed his poems in Persian, which portrayed his love for India and his pride of being an Indian. Thus, language and literature were influenced by people who came and made the subcontinent their home. Here are some pictures of the instrument. They are sarangi, tabla and sitar. About Amir Khusro, 1253 to 1325. Amir Khusro took pride in being an Indian. He says, "I have praised India for two reasons. First, because India is the land of my birth and our country. Love of the country is an important obligation. Hindustan is like heaven. Its climate is better than that of Khurasan. It is green and full of flowers all the year round." Khusro's love for India shows that the Turkish ruling class was no longer prepared to behave as a foreign ruling class and that the ground had been prepared for an interaction between cultures of Indian origin and those from outside India. Khusro has praised the Indian languages including Hindi, which he calls Hindavi. Some of his scattered Hindi verses are found, though the Hindi work, Khalik Bari, often attributed to Khusro, was in all probability the work of a later poet of the same name. He was also an accomplished musician and took part in religious musical gatherings. Page 31. As regards Indian food, the medieval period was particularly significant. The coming of Arabs, Central Asians, Persians and Turks had tremendous influence on Indian cuisine. The Muslims from Western Asia brought Mughal cuisine to India in the 12th century when Mughal rulers conquered a large part of India. Elaborate dishes were prepared for the Mughal emperors with dry fruits and nuts. The rich aromatic food of the Mughals, in which a variety of exotic spices, dry fruits and nuts, fragrances, milk and cream were used, continues to be an important part of the Indian cuisine. Spices such as black pepper, cinnamon, nutmeg, cloves and ginger were used in Mughal cuisine. The biryani, korma, pulao, grilled meats including kebabs are popular even today. When Babur invaded India, he brought his food habits such as grilled meat along with different varieties of fruits and nuts from Central Asia. Humayun introduced a new tradition of rice-based pulao and meat stews. The dum style of cooking in a sealed pot is largely associated with Mughlai style of cooking. In the field of sports, some games that became popular and continue to be played to this day are chess, chopper, nard, which is Persian backgammon, and cards. Amir Khusro and Malik Muhammad Jaisi make numerous references to the game of chess, a game that was popular among people. Another variety of chess referred to as Shatranj-e-Kameel or quadruple chess was also played during this period. Pulao is also known as Palav in Telugu and Pulao in Marathi and Pulao in Tamil. In India, pulao, which is essentially a rice preparation, may also contain variety of vegetables and meat depending on the local preparation. Hospice is a lodging house for travelers, especially one kept by a religious order for the groups. About Sufis. Sufis had become very prominent in Islam at a very early stage. Most of them were people of deep devotion and focused on a simple life. Some of the early Sufis, such as the woman mystic Rabia and Mansur bin Halaj, laid great emphasis on love as the bond between God and the individual soul. The link between the teacher or Pir nominated a successor or Wali to carry on his work. The Sufi saints were popular among the common people as they adopted musical recitation called Sama, which emphasized on love and nearness to God. Many times they chose Hindi verses for these purposes. Also, Nizamuddin Aulia adopted yogic breathing exercises so much so that common people called him a Siddh or perfect. The monastic organization of the Sufis and some of their practices such as penance, fasting and holding the breath are sometimes traced to the Buddhist and Hindu yogic influence. Page 32. People belonging to the ruling class were fond of polo, while horse racing was also a popular outdoor game. This game had its origin in Persia. It is mentioned in historical records that Qutubuddin Aibak died of an accident while playing polo at Lahore. Turks were very fond of the game. Rajput rulers of the Sultanate and Mughal periods were skilled in playing polo. Another important development that influenced the lives and conditions of all sections of society was the spread of Sufism from the 11th century onwards. During this century, a large number of Sufis came from Central Asia and settled in Hindustan. This process was strengthened with the establishment of Delhi Sultanate. The Chishti Silsila was among the most influential orders. It had a long line of teachers like Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti of Ajmer, Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Khaki of Delhi, Khwaja Nizamuddin Aulia of Delhi, and Banda Nawaz Gisudaraz of Gulbarga. The Sufis were Muslim mystics. They emphasized on love and devotion to God and compassion towards their fellow beings. Like the Bhakti saints, the Sufis rejected elaborate rituals and emphasized on love as the medium of union with God. The Sufis held their assemblies in Khanqah. Devotees of all descriptions, including members of the royalty, nobility, and ordinary people, visited Khanqahs. Even today, people visit Dargah to seek blessings and also to participate in the Qawwali sessions. 11वीं शताब्दी में सूफी मत ने भारतीय समाज को प्रभावित किया. सूफी लोग धर्म के बाहरी आडंबरों को अस्वीकार करते हुए ईश्वर के प्रति प्रेम और भक्ति तथा सभी मनुष्यों के प्रति दया भाव रखने पर बल देते थे. Khanqahs are a spacious building which provided accommodation for visitors and travelers. Amir Khusro took part in musical gatherings. Sama was organized by the famous Sufi saint Nizamuddin Aulia. He gave a unique form to the Chishti Sama by introducing the call, Arabic word meaning is saying, a hymn sung at the opening or closing of Qawwali. This was followed by Sufi poetry in Persian, Hindi or Urdu languages. This was sung by Qawwals. Qawwals are those who sing these songs. Today, Qawwali is performed in shrines all over the subcontinent. Page number 33. People attributed Sufi saints with miraculous powers that could relieve them of their illness, pain and troubles. The tomb or dargah of Sufi saints became places of pilgrimage to which flocked thousands of people belonging to different communities. Even today, a large number of people from different faiths and communities visit Sufi shrines such as that of Moinuddin Chishti in Ajmer and the dargah of Nizamuddin Aulia in Delhi. Exercise. Let's recall. 1. Mention the names of foreign travelers who came to India at different points of time. 2. Why did they come? 3. What did they write about the life and conditions of India's past? Let's discuss. 4. You are doing many activities in Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalaya like karate, music, dance, etc. How far do you think are these influenced by cultures of different states of India or foreign countries? 5. Are there any Khanqah or Dargah in your town or village? Find out when these were built and what are the activities associated with them. Let's do. 6. Collect pictures of paintings and crafts of your village and make a scrapbook. 7. Make picture albums of monuments and write short descriptions.
Kaun hai Bharatvasi?
भाषा रंग रूप वेश भाषा ना थी जिनकी एक जाने कितने ही देशों से भारत आए लोग अनेक करने व्यापार
विविधता भरी सभ्यता का
फिर यही बने आ रंग रूप वेश भाषा ना थी जिनकी एक। जाने कितने ही देशों से भारत आए लोग अनेक। भारतवासी
नहीं जान सकता यह कोई,
हमने बसी एकता ऐसी।
रंग रूप वेश भाषा, रंग रूप वेश भाषा ना थी जिनकी एक। जाने कितने ही देशों से भारत आए लोग अनेक। जाने कितने ही देशों से भारत आए लोग अनेक।
You were just listening to this chapter 5, People Who Came and Made an Impact.